Hey there, I'm Ben Pendery.
And I'm James Hogan, and this is the March edition of Western Wednesdays. Ben, the music that's playing right now behind us...
It sounds great.
It's really cool. And believe it or not, it was written by today's podcast guest, Amanda Muse.
You know that I believe it, because... When we found out that she was willing to do this for us, I think we were all pretty excited.
Yes.
Knowing what she brings to have an alumna of that kind of caliber is really, really awesome. And you and Stacy got to spend some time with her. That was great.
Class of 2017. And we had a great time talking to her. She was in her sunny studio in Southern California.
I love that. And you and Stacy made sure to remind her that it was pouring the rain here in Cullowhee. I'm sure that made her feel great.
Yeah, it was a terrible day, and you'll hear about that more. But, you know, I want to just start off by saying this. You don't get a sense of it in this interview because we're doing it on Zoom. Amanda Muse is like 5 feet, 1 inch tall. And years ago, we're going to link this in the show notes, but Sam Wallace here did a fantastic profile video of her when she was a student in the Pride of the Mountains marching band. And I only mention her physical stature because she's in this drum line, this whole like line of snare drum players. And she's just a very small person carrying this very large drum. And she does it in such a way that you just forget about the fact that it's little Amanda Muse with this big snare drum. And Matt Henley talks about her in this video as saying, like, she plays big. Mm. She, you know, she acts out the part, and you forget about her stature because she just performs in such a way. And I say all of that to say this: her tenacity, her can-do attitude, her energy. I think that you're going to see a lot of that in this interview, and the way that she has harnessed that to be successful in her career as a film composer.
One of my favorite things when she's going to talk about Matt Henley in the earliest part of this interview, and you know I was not in the band, which will come as a surprise to no one.
You could have,
but
done
I was
that.
I was a history major, and I was a history and poli sci major, and listening to her talk about the instructors that she had in the Pride of the Mountains. Listening to her talk about what drew her here, what kept her here, and how she stayed motivated as a student who was not a music major, and I know you're going to talk about that.
Yeah.
But you know, thinking about the way that she talked about Matt Henley as one of her instructors, and John, and those instructors in the band. Every single one of us who came to Western, who fell in love with this place, and had a mentor, a professor, a faculty member, a staff member, you're going to find something that you relate to in this interview. And that's what I thought was really great, because she talked about that with such passion about the people that made that experience for her here.
And I think to your point about her major, so spoiler alert, Amanda Muse, psychology major. Of course she's a film composer. She was a psychology major at WCU.
It tracks.
It totally tracks, right? She talks about it, though, as a tool that helps her stand out in Hollywood. And if you, I mean, I can't even begin to imagine how hard it is to hack it as a creative artist in Los Angeles, right? In Hollywood. I mean, it is a dog-eat-dog world out there. But what does she do? She finds an edge. She finds a way to show up. And she uses things that she developed here, thanks to her relationships, thanks to the people in her life in Cullowhee, that she still carries with her now in this new career as a film composer. It's so cool.
The doggedness and the resilience that comes out, I forget your exact quote, but you know the courage and the resilience that she builds here at Western that gets her motivated to literally drive across the country.
Yeah,
yeah,
yeah. You're going to hear that story and more, and we'll just cut to the chase and get to this interview, because we'll keep talking about it and spoil the entire thing, because it was such fun.
Y'all got to watch it and listen to it. It's great.
All right, let's cut to it now. Amanda, it's great to have you here on Western Wednesdays. Welcome from your home studio in sunny California. How are you?
Yeah, thank you. Thanks so much for having me. I'm great here, like you said, in sunny California.
It's always cool to talk to a catamount on the West Coast. a long way from Cullowhee, from this valley here. And so I just wanted to start off back here in North Carolina and ask you just to tell us a little bit about yourself and tell us what brought you to WCU. How did you end up as a Catamount?
It's so funny. And you're going to judge me. I judge myself for this. But I wanted to go to WCU because I found out the band was going to Macy's. And I knew I wanted to go out of state initially. I just wanted somewhere fresh. I grew up in Orlando, Florida. You know, it's very flat and cool, but I wanted seasons, and I had never seen snow or anything like that. And I had visited North Carolina once before, and I just thought the state was so beautiful. So I wanted to go in like that mountainy kind of area, and it was between University of Tennessee and WCU, and I chose WCU because of the marching band.
Heck yeah,
truly. Yeah, that's kind of why I made that decision. And marching band was actually a really important factor for me choosing a college, because I wanted to continue that and continue playing snare. So that was kind of the reason that brought WCU to my attention.
So, Amanda, you were a snare player in high school. Had you marched drum and bugle corps or anything like that?
No, I was a flute player in like concert band and wind ensemble and all that. I was a wind player. But I was always interested in percussion, and I eventually tried out for the snare line and made it in my 10th grade year. So I went from flute to snare in high school, and those were like such great years and super fun to be in the drum line. I was like, yeah, I'm going to continue this, of course. I'm not ready to finish this. So yeah, I made that transition and definitely wanted to continue.
You clearly had chops if you made it.
Absolutely. Yeah, and that's quite the change, right?
Yeah.
I mean, that's a big adjustment.
It was a lot of like background work, and you know, I would be out in my backyard trying to like carry a snare and learn how to march with a snare, and it was
those
a
poor
lot
neighbors.
Of yeah, I know, and I still have like neighbors that I know hate me because, but yeah, it was an interesting transition that I was like so proud of.
I bet, I love it.
That's exciting. Amanda, you know, one thing that I always love to hear in these interviews and, you know, and in talking with alumni is about the people that, you know, that influenced them while they were here in Cullowhee, you know, in their time. Mm-hmm. Could you maybe share with us a little bit about, you know, some of those people who were important influences on you in your time here at Western?
Yeah. Of course, the psychology faculty, because my major was psychology, so all of my professors were wonderful, and I'd say the biggest impact, though, was probably the marching band directors, David, Matt, and John, especially Matt Henley. We were very close, and he was always such a great mentor and friend and someone who was always there. You know, he was my teacher, and then eventually we worked together. I was brought on to teach the purple line, so he was like kind of my boss. But we stayed close. He was always there for me, someone I could always talk to about anything. Especially around the time that my mom passed away, he was there for that period of time, and just always a very good listener, very emotionally perceptive, had high standards for the percussion section. And I respected that a lot. I looked up to him a lot, and he was a very, very important person to me in my chapter at WCU.
Psychology major. That means, you know, obviously psychology major, right? We did a Western Wednesday last season with Jack Eady, our current director of the Pride of the Mountains, and several students who are in the Pride of the Mountains marching band. I'm sure you know they're going to Ireland here this spring, and it's a huge opportunity for them.
So cool.
It is, right?
It's unbelievable.
One of the things we talked about, there are so many non-music majors in WC's marching band, and it's more common than not that they're not a music major.
Did you
ever realize that, or were you ever kind of aware of that as when you were in the band?
I knew there it was full of non-music majors just because the band is like just so, it has such a great reputation at the school. It's the reason a lot of people go. And I knew that there were a lot of non-music majors. I mean, there's so many great opportunities, and the band takes you so many amazing places. We had so many amazing trips. So it's like, yeah, why not join this, even if you're, you know, not a music major? It's all about the experience, I think, for those types of people.
It is too, right? It is such an experience. And you know, what the band members go through, you know, I put that preseason preparation up against the very best of them.
It's okay. You can call it band camp.
The number of hours spent, you know, now on the asphalt, right? You know, on the old parking lot. It's just unbelievable. You know what those what you guys put yourselves through to prepare and be ready, and that's why you crush it, right?
Yeah, definitely. It's like a own little tiny like drum corps in and of itself. It's like the college type drum corps of college bands, if that makes any sense.
I like to think that that means it's a lot more fun.
Yeah, definitely. I mean, the payoff is totally worth it, and the pride that you get seeing those videos and stuff, and seeing the people in the stands just going wild, and some people saying that they come to the game just sometimes just to see the band. And yeah, I mean, that gives you kind of a sense of pride that you're bringing in that traffic.
It's like being a rock and roll star.
Yeah, totally. Yeah.
So it doesn't have to be a band experience, Amanda, but I'm thinking about those experiences on the field. I'm thinking about experiences elsewhere, but I'm just wondering, like, what you were class of 2017 here at Western.
Yeah.
So you spent your time here then. And what experiences stand out to you? What do you remember back from those college years?
Well, seeing snow for the first time, I'll never forget that day. It was my freshman year. It was like January 11th or something like that. But I know, I remember
that's pretty specific.
And it started snowing. It was a really light snow, but I had wanted to see that so bad. I was like, I was 18 and I had never seen snow. And I called home and like left this message, and I went, it started to snow heavily after that day. It was like a few days, and went sledding with a few friends, like just down the little tiny hill near Balsam. It was just like a tiny hill. And there were just people out like building snowmen, and it was the cutest thing. And we went to Starbucks and got our hot chocolates. It was so wholesome. So that was an amazing moment of joy. And then I think whenever the fall leaves would be, it was like a week in October, it was like the peak of the fall leaves. That was always a time that I looked forward to. So gorgeous. I would sometimes just walk around and take pictures. And, you know, if you don't come from an area like that, like an area that gets the seasons, everything's just, you're like walking around with heart eyes. It's so beautiful. So definitely the seasons. And then, yeah, of course, everywhere that the band took us, you know, Macy's, of course. We went to a few other places. We went to we did go to Florida for a competition exhibition, and just amazing experiences and places with the band.
I mean, I want to shift a little bit, you are a two-time graduate and had some time here in graduate school as well. So, you know, how did your, you know, experience kind of shift from being an undergraduate student in the band every day and then kind of transitioning as a graduate student here in Colleen?
Yeah. Yeah, I went back home to Florida to kind of figure out what I wanted to do. I had just finished my degree in psychology, and I had this interest for a period of time about project management. And I saw this degree at NYU, it's a project management degree. It was only like a year program for your master's in project management. And I always kind of wanted to live in New York. So I did it for the experience and learning about project management. I moved up to New York for a few months. But during that period of time, I was still feeling like I had something in me that wanted to continue percussion. And I was like really hungry to teach at the time. I wasn't ready to let all of that go, like the drumline world and all of that. So I got a hold of Matt Henley, and I was like, I'm just curious if you have a drumline instructor for Purple Line for next year. And he was like, yeah, do you want to do it? And I was like, yeah. So
yeah, it was you, actually. We were thinking it would be you, so.
Yeah, so I went back to Colby, and I decided to finish my project management degree online. So I did the first half in person in New York during the coldest months of the year. And then went back to Colby to
do... And you thought you got snow here.
I know. That was cold. But went back to Colby and stayed teaching Purple Line for the next couple seasons. And then during that like year and a half, I finished my NYU degree in project management. But during that year, it kind of cemented my decision to pursue music as my career, because I was doing a lot of writing for drum lines and teaching, and it was just kind of a period of time that I needed to figure that out and needed to figure out my path. So that was a really important time, and I finally came to the decision that I wanted to pursue music and I wanted to compose for more than just drumline. I wanted to do orchestral composing. So I, you know, I looked into film scoring and I looked into master's degrees because I felt that I needed the formal education in that. So I found, you know, I found a degree, master's program here in LA, Cal State LA. So I moved here in January 2020. Yeah.
Oh, that's a great time to pick up and move, right? Like across the country.
Yeah.
Yeah, yeah. You had exactly 6 good weeks there, right?
I know. And then the world shut down, right? But right. I was, during that period of time, I was planning on kind of being cooped in anyway because I had to train myself and write and compose these pieces to get into that master's program, because that was how you got accepted. They'd listen to your pieces. So I wrote those pieces and got accepted to Cal State Master's in Music Composition, and finally had the formal training that I was craving for music composition.
So,
and then,
I'm sorry to interrupt you. I just want to make sure I get this straight. You pick up from Jackson County, North Carolina, move all the way to Los Angeles, but you hadn't gotten in yet.
Mm-hmm.
Like,
right, that's like, correct.
So, I mean, damned and determined comes to mind.
Yeah.
You know, And sorry, that may not be the best way to put it, but like,
no, I totally, yeah, you're right.
I mean,
I was kind of put all my drums and my keyboards in my car and like a suitcase of clothes and literally drove myself across the country alone.
Wow.
With no one else in the car. And, yeah.
So
I knew that I would end up here eventually. My sister was living in Los Angeles at the time. So luckily I had one person that I knew here. But, literally just drove myself here without a job lined up, without even getting into the program yet. But I knew that I had to make it work somehow.
And at this point, you mentioned that you'd done some compositions. I know also, like,
yeah,
you've published two books on percussion as well.
Yeah.
We were watching, actually, before your interview, Sam played for us again the video that WCU made for you, of you. Aww. As a student. And so here's 5'1" Amanda Muse out there on the turf with a snare drum, hanging with everybody else on that field. That persistence, that motivation, that drives you, that says, you know, yes, of course I'm going to get into the program. I just have to move out there and write the music and get into the program, but I'll get into the program. Like, where does that come from, Amanda? Can you trace that back somewhere?
It comes from being stubborn. One thing about me is I chase after things, and I like do whatever it takes to get that thing. And yeah, it's just, I've just always been a goal-oriented person, and I like the feeling of achieving things and achieving goals that I go after. And I'm that person that will like just do what it takes to get it. You know, to get what I want.
Were you always like that? Stubborn. Were you like that as a child or as a grade school kid?
As a baby, I would cry if I didn't get like a stuffed animal or something. I would make a stink out of it, probably. Yeah. No, but I don't know. I think as like a teen, yeah, I would do what it takes to like study and ace the tests, and yeah, I guess it was always kind of like that, but it got more like that when I realized my passion for music and knowing that this needed to work out because there's no other plan.
that's fantastic. Yeah, there's no safety net here.
No.
Right.
No, you're going to sink or swim, and you have, you know, you found a way to swim every time, and and I think that's really admirable, right? And that's amazing.
Thank you.
So, Amanda, you graduated from Cal State. You kind of jump into this world of film scoring, and for our audience's sake, like I was wondering if you could just tell us a little bit about film scoring as a business. Like I know my reference is like the Jack Black character in the movie The Holiday, right? Where he's sitting around and like,
you know,
vibing with the movie and playing on a keyboard. Mm-hmm. So what's it really like? What's that process look like from your perspective?
Yeah. Yeah. You get the job. You first get the job through the director. It's all word of mouth. You don't like apply on LinkedIn or Indeed for like a film composer job. It's all through knowing directors and friends of directors and recommendations. It's all word of mouth. That's why networking is so important. So you get the job. You will make, you know, a demo for them. You discuss the project that they're coming up with, and they may ask you to do like a demo of what you're picturing for that score. And once, you know, once it's sealed, once you think you're a good fit, you like the project, they like your music, you'll sign the contract and get to writing. So it's usually, I mean, it could be anywhere from a 4 to 8 week process, depending on how much music you're writing for the film. So if it's, in normal full-length film, maybe you'll be writing like 40 minutes, maybe you'll be writing 60 minutes of music. It's always different. So you finish your mock-ups, you finish all of your cues, you get them approved. Obviously, you have to get them approved by the director. And then if you have a big enough budget for the movie, you're going to want to record live. You want to record these instruments live. It's always going to sound better than a software program. So you book a recording session, and sometimes that'll be one day. Sometimes that'll be a few days of the musicians reading the piece through and you directing that session. And yeah, they're literally sight reading all of your cues, which is so cool, by the way. And you get through that. Sometimes there's last minute changes to the score and you kind of have to adjust on the spot. But, you know, once you finish your live recording sessions, you send it to the dub stage and they mix your music into the movie. And then you're kind of wrapped up by that point and praying for another job. Yeah.
That's amazing that they sight read it.
It's incredible. And that was, I've done a few live sessions where they sight read my pieces and I'll never forget that feeling of like just putting your music in front of these professional musicians. They nail it on the first take. And it's just so cool to be in that room. It's so cool.
Yeah, because, you know, until now, it's kind of the music's walked around in your head, right? Like, you've heard it, obviously, you've synthesized it, and et cetera. But now to feel that full humanity.
It's coming to life.
It's amazing.
That's so cool.
Yeah.
I mean, I'm going to, you talked, you know, about your stubbornness kind of helping get you, you know, get you where you are. I'm going to use the words tenacity. And persistence.
I'll take that. I'll take it.
But clearly, you know, we've talked about, you know, how those characteristics and that drive that you have really, you know, got you where you are, got you where you were here, and got you where you are now. So clearly, it's led you to success professionally as well. And so, can you share with us a little bit about that and what's been a standout moment for you on the professional front? We talked a lot about your time here at Western, but you know, since you've made a career of this and found some success, you know, what's been a standout moment, one that, you know, one or two that really shine and maybe
that you'll carry with you? There's been a couple. I started, you know, once I got accepted into the master's program at Cal State, I also got a part-time work at a company called CineSamples. So they're a virtual instrument company and they make orchestral samples for composers. And so it was my introduction kind of into the industry. And I started out as kind of a general assistant and then a few months later was promoted to a full-time producer. So I got to produce these sessions and record these live instruments. And there were a couple sessions at these amazing scoring stages, the 20th Century Fox stage. I got to conduct, it was the first place I've gone to conduct one of my orchestral compositions. And I got to conduct the brass section, one of my chorales, and that was like just such a fulfilling moment, just being on that stage where people like John Williams have stood there conducting, and you just know the history of the room is incredible. And so we did Fox Studios, and we also did Sony scoring stage. We did an orchestral recording session, and I got to again have one of my pieces recorded and got to stand there and conduct. And those two moments were just so, like, just, I can't even describe that feeling of, what am I doing right now? Like, how did this happen? Yeah, it's a humbling, beautiful, amazing experiences. And I just got to have, again, one of my pieces recorded by a full orchestra in Scotland. It's a piece called Wings Like Eagles, and I wrote it for the orchestra. They were looking for someone to, have something recorded in their scoring stage, and kind of, since they're kind of building, but to have my piece played by them was just a beautiful, amazing, amazing moment and super fulfilling. So yeah, it's usually whenever my pieces are played by live musicians, that those are just the standout moments for me.
Amanda, I want to throw a question at you. Where does the inspiration for these compositions come from? I want to just also acknowledge your last name is Muse. I mean, like, for an artist, for a creative artist, it's the perfect name. And I'm just curious, what, you know, where do these songs come from?
I mean, they always start with playing around on my keyboards and knowing what, you know, you have like a goal for the whole, like the culmination of the piece. Like, I wanted Wings Like Eagles. I wanted it to sound inspiring and uplifting and adventurous. And I wanted it to have a little bit of a Scottish influence because it was being recorded in Scotland. So I had that in mind, and I just start playing around and come up with melodies. Melody is just the most important part of the piece of music because it keeps the listener interested. So yeah, it's always just, the inspiration just comes from just knowing what you want it to sound like. I don't know if that makes sense, but knowing kind of the feeling, right, the feeling that you want the listener to get, mm-hmm, mm-hmm, when they hear it. And then you somehow turn that into, you know, melodies and chords.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Yeah. And structure and,
yeah, a whole recipe. It's like cooking. Like, you gotta have the perfect amount of everything to make that delicious cake.
Well, and not to try and get too into the weeds of it, but yeah, like, there's a chordal structure. There's a compositional structure, right? There, you know, depending on what kind, yeah, of piece you're writing, you know, how many different themes. There might be, you know, one melody, an A piece, and then a B piece, and,
right,
you know, all of that. I'll keep it at that level to kind of transition to this next question, and that's about, the world is kind of losing its mind about artificial intelligence, right? Mm-hmm. For fun, a few weeks ago, I can't even remember what the line was, but we were sitting around the office, and one of our colleagues here in alumni engagement came up with some goofball line that I said, that sounds like the most hilarious, satirical country Christmas song ever. And we're like, somebody needs to write that. And somebody else says, well, artificial intelligence can write that. So, you know, like, you know, we open ChatGPT, is like, yeah, you know, can you write a song around this? And by God, it did. And it rhymed.
Yeah.
And it even wrote a bridge. And, right? Like, now, granted, these were
so
just
so funny,
right? You know, these were just,
and scary, yeah.
Right, yeah, and this was, these were lyrics, right? This was not any kind of composition. But so, I say all that, yeah, to say this, you know, what does the industry think right now? What do people in Hollywood think about, yeah, artificial intelligence?
It's a scary time. It's always part of the conversation now, especially we just, you know, they just had the strikes, the writer strikes and the actor strikes, and artificial intelligence was part of the reason for that. You know, they want protection and, mm-hmm, to be able to have the right to say, you can't recreate me as an AI unless you have my permission. So it's scary. Yeah. And for for composers, it can definitely take away jobs, specifically for things like ambient tones or library music, where you're just, you know, a director is just kind of picking out a general sounding track. That can be absolutely written by AI and replace some jobs. But there's always going to be quality directors who want a quality piece of music written to their picture. There's something that you can't replace, the human aspect of it and the psychology aspect of it. AI can learn and like do what it's trained to do, but it's still not human. And it's kind of like, some composers are thinking of it as, let's use it to our advantage somehow. Let's get before this, you know, get ahead of this thing, and maybe we could use it to our advantage. Think of it like a tripod, like someone, you know, a tripod can take away technically a photographer's job because a person can just, you know, put their camera on the tripod, but it doesn't have the same touch as a human, you know, photographer. They have that eye, that creative look. And so you can use that more so as a tool. And photographers use tripods as tools. So that's how I think a lot of composers are trying to look at it now, as let's not freak out yet. It's not... You know, it's going to get more advanced, but it's not there yet. And I don't see it being able to fully replace film composers at all in the near future. So that's kind of where we're at.
Amanda, as you think, you know, think through some of that, and you think back on, you know, on your early education, let's talk about, you know, your time as a psychology major and with the, you know, with the things that you're doing now, the things that you're seeing now, and, you know, and some of these, how do you feel that, you know, that what you learned in, you know, in psychology is helping you in your career field now that most think, well, has nothing to do with it, right?
Yeah. Oh my gosh, so much. And anytime I tell other people that my undergrad isn't in music, it's in psychology, they're like so interested and it becomes the topic of the conversation, because it's, first off, it's different on a resume. I've gotten more attention for having a different looking resume than like just a kind of something you'd expect for composer. But yeah, it's just so involved in the process of writing to a picture and writing to a scene. You're framing a scene, you're perceiving emotions and putting that into music, and you're working with a director, you're working with people, and you have to know how to be conscientious with them and treat people, and it's just so useful in the career. There have been times where I was like, oh, should I have majored in music at, you know, when I was doing my bachelor's? And years later, I'm like, now I'm so grateful that it was psychology, because it truly has given me such an advantage, and just knowing people and knowing emotions and mind and how the brain works and behavior and all of that. So it's been a great background to have.
What about some of the, you know, I when I hear you say that, I immediately am thinking about some of those professors that you would have had in the psychology department and the Wendy Gordons, you know, and that whole group, and the outside of the textbook things that were learned in that department. I mean, I just think they're so amazing. They're known for that over there. And some of those outside of the textbook experiences, which is what we talk a lot about here, right? Mm-hmm. At Western is really driving that home and being about that. It's not just about being the number in the seat and, right. Some of those things that, that you're talking about, right? And how it has influenced you and your career these years later, learned in, again, in a major that really most would see is not, doesn't have anything to do with what you're doing.
Right.
But because of a lot of that, you're able to really apply it and be better than a lot of others, with that.
Yeah, it's so funny because I was having lunch with the composer who did Netflix's Wednesday show, Chris Bacon, who worked with Danny Elfman to do the show. I was having lunch with them about maybe, possibly working together in the future or something. And that was like the main topic of conversation was psychology and how valuable it is to have that and how much it comes into play in the job. So it's like, it's so cool. And I'm very grateful for that.
Amanda, you mentioned Danny Elfman. I shamelessly follow you on Instagram because I think it's hilarious to see some of the experiences that you found yourself in. I think that you ended up like at the Hollywood Bowl watching John Williams.
Oh, yeah. Twice.
If I had known that experience was possible, I think I would have found a way to California for that.
Yes. Oh my gosh. And he's like still going strong. He's 90 something. Yes. And he stands there for hours conducting, and it's mind blowing.
It is. So for our Western Wednesdays listeners who may not know the names Danny Elfman and John Williams, like these are some of the most prolific film composers ever. You would know them by their music. You would, all you have to do is take two notes and go ba-dum, ba-dum, ba-dum. And that's John Williams, right? And the music that we so associate with these beloved films comes from, an interesting group of people. And so, Amanda, I just have to ask you in where you are, who's a standout composer? What's a film score that you absolutely love?
One of my favorites will always be Pirates of the Caribbean, by Hans Zimmer.
Oh,
who
yeah.
did the score for those, and particularly the third movie. He has such incredible tracks in there, and he kind of combines like this rock influence because he has a rock background. So he combines like electric guitar and just massive percussion in the score. And I used to have that score on repeat, like in the car. We would always have it going, and particularly, now, yeah.
Like your friends must have loved that. Like, oh God, Amanda's driving.
Here we go.
We're gonna have to listen.
No, really though, because I was friends with band nerds, and we would like it's so nerdy. We would just like rock out to the Kraken, which is like it's so funny. Yeah, the Kraken is a great track, and Up is Down. Listen to Up is Down from the third movie. It's really percussive and amazing and vibrant and just energetic. So yeah, Hans Zimmer, I'd have to say, has really, really influenced me and a lot of other composers in LA.
Sure. Do you ever find yourself having just come up with a lick or a melody line or something, and you have to go, oh no, wait, that's Hans Zimmer.
I mean, his sound is so, he's created a sound. It's extremely different than John Williams. It's two different ends of the spectrum. And now the problem is everyone wants to sound like Hans Zimmer in film scoring, and directors want their soundtracks to sound like him. They're like, can you just be Hans Zimmer? And us composers are like, wait, but I have my own original sound. And he's created the modern day film scoring sound that a lot of directors are after. So yeah,
I'm sure that you could be like Hans Zimmer for Hans Zimmer's budget. Like, you're like, sure. Yeah, if right. you'll sign that contract, then I'll be whoever you want me to be.
Yeah, exactly. I heard once he had like 20 drum sets in a recording studio. Oh, wow. Like, he just does this massively insane things that it's like.
He did Interstellar, right?
Yes.
That. Mm-hmm. Did you see Interstellar?
No.
Oh, the soundtrack for that film, I just remembered at the time, because I saw it in the theater, and I needed hearing aids afterward because it was just, I mean, it was like huge. Yeah. It was enormous.
And Inception.
Yes. Oh, yeah.
Yeah. So the Batman movies. He did the Batman movies.
Yeah.
He did satisfying. Cool Runnings too, fun fact.
No kidding.
Yeah. Yep. Oh, wow.
That's and one. Lion King. A lot of people don't remember that. He did Lion King. Yeah.
Well, okay. See, there you go.
There you go.
I have one more question before we move to kind of our next little thing. That tenacity that we were talking about earlier, Amanda, that's got to serve you well in Los Angeles.
It has to. I mean, that's, it's a tough world out here to find a job. It's competitive and everyone wants to do what you want to do. People move out here to achieve their dreams. So you have to be different. You have to find a way to have your own sound and identity and reason for someone to want to hire you. So yeah, I try to use my drive to keep me going, you know, keep that little candle lit.
have you
hasn't
done
failed me yet.
Have you like barged in on somebody's coffee date or something, or just, you know, sat down across from somebody famous and said, hi, I know you're waiting on your salad, but.
I don't know if I can be that person. if I'm in person, I'll do like cold emails and just. But it's the thing is everyone does cold emails. They just reach out to people they don't know. So these people are getting hundreds of these. And that's why it's really is networking, in-person events, and word of mouth, these relationships, and the trust is the most valuable thing in the mind of these directors. So yeah, networking events are really important.
Amanda, we've talked about, you know, different composers that you've really looked up to, that, you know, that you enjoy, you admire, you know, and appreciate their work. But you composed the theme music for Western Wednesdays, right? And
yeah.
So, go ahead.
And I was going to say, like, this is something that we debuted about a year ago, and we used it last season, and we've been using it. You heard it. You may not have realized that you heard Amanda's tune right at the beginning of this episode, but you did. And hey, thank you, by the way.
Absolutely.
Like,
thank you. Oh my gosh, it was an incredible honor, and made me feel like things came full circle. Anything for my alma mater, always.
Can you, and we appreciate that very much. Can you tell us a little bit, you know, that's got to be a little bit different than a lot of the things that you're working on. So, you know, what motivation, you know, did you have in that piece? What kind of influenced you in the direction that you went with that? Can you share with us a little bit about that?
Yeah, I think, James, when we had that initial call, I think you told me something like, write how going to WCU made you feel.
Yeah.
Of course, include some, if we can include some of that marching band aspect or drumline aspect. So I was going to, yes, definitely include some of my snare. But in terms of like the chord progression and the melody, I was just thinking uplifting and warm and endless opportunities, something that makes you feel like you could take on the world and like the world is your oyster. So anything uplifting and positive, and I eventually have my piano here.
Oh, that's so
I don't know if you could hear. Let me know if the audio is.
Oh, yeah. That's perfect. Yeah.
Yeah. So I was messing around with these chords that kind of made me feel good and warm. And then I came up with the melody. Kind of like that. And then something I do often in my pieces is this is musical language, but I'll like flatten the sixth and seventh degree of the scale. So you have a normal C scale, but you flat the sixth and seventh, and it'll kind of make it feel uplifting. So then it came up with that uplifting part of the melody. I was happy with that, so I kind of just continued on with that and made it into some strings and some live percussion. I recorded my snare drum live again. Sorry to my neighbors. I did like four separate tracks because I wanted it to sound like more than just one snare, and you can't just copy and paste or else it'll sound weird. So I did like four separate takes as if it was like four snare players, and then did some live shaker. I just had so much fun with it. It was an amazing opportunity.
I think that was the first live performance of the Western Wednesday theme ever. on Western Wednesdays. Sam is here. He's got the theme music kind of queued up, and let's just listen to that. The first 15-20 seconds, Sam, if that'll work. Feels so big. And Amanda, I'm sorry for putting my imagery on this, but like I feel the mountains. I feel kind of the grandeur of the setting. I feel this is and also I think the snare drum, it feels like we're marking time, right?
Mm-hmm.
You know, there's not like calendar pages turning here, but you know, this is timely. This is meaning something important. We're marching forward. That's my English major read.
I like it.
Yeah, you're about to get into an amazing podcast discussion.
Right?
Let's gear up for this.
Let's do it.
And I love how you're talking about just kind of how the melody kind of inspires you. It's warm. You can do it. Yeah.
Yeah, that's how going to WCU made me feel, is warm and nostalgic and like anything is possible.
I
want a billboard.
Yeah, right. Let's put that on the billboard, please. I wanted to ask you one more question, Amanda. If you could go back 10 years and find young Amanda Muse, who's here probably as a first-year student, and you could kind of grab her by the shoulders and tell her anything, what would you tell yourself 10 years ago?
I guess I would say go after the thing that you know you want instead of going after, or instead of feeling like, don't judge yourself for the thing that you know you kind of want, because you're going to do that anyway. Like, I know he's had that kind of feeling that I wanted to kind of pursue music, but I didn't. And I don't regret it. I don't regret doing psychology or anything like that. But just don't judge yourself for wanting that, because you're going to do it anyway because you're stubborn. So so just ride the ride. Like, sit back and ride the ride and be patient, because these things unfold slowly, and it's, you know, it's always worked out. And just be positive and look forward to the amazing things that are going to happen, and live in the moment, because I think we should all like live in the moment more and be where our feet are, because I tend to think so much into the future and so goal driven to almost a fault where I'm like, okay, what's next? But sometimes I wish I could just, like, you know, just be where my feet are and have a cup of coffee or tea.
Amanda, I'm so grateful for your time today. I'm very grateful for the creative spirit and energy that you shared here at Western, both as a student and now as a graduate and composer, composer of our Western Wednesdays theme music. Thank you. Thank you so much for this interview.
Thank you so much for having me. It was great to talk to you guys and walk down memory lane of a very, very important chapter in my life. So thank you all.
Folks, you just had the chance to listen to Stacy Miller and James Hogan interview Amanda Muse, WCU class of 17, and that was absolutely remarkable. Thank you for bringing us that, and how much fun did you all have talking with her?
I had a great time. I had a great time. I don't know about our director of alumni engagement, Stacy Miller.
There's nobody better, really. And watching Stacy wander through the right way to talk about Bandcamp, it gives you a sense of the power of the zeitgeist when it comes to Bandcamp. I thought she did a great job, though.
No, she did a great job. She did a fantastic job. She had good questions. But here's the thing. At the end of the day, I love that interview because Amanda breaks down something that you and I know. Like, you've been to the movies. You've heard the music. And it's such an important part of cinema, of the whole experience of a film. The music tells the story and helps convey so many pieces of it. And we didn't even hear all of what we talked about. What's funny is we had to cut out a big section in the middle of this interview because Amanda's yard service showed up and all you could hear was a leaf blower in the background. But, you know, there are so many different pieces, motifs, ideas around cinema and music that are like everybody can experience that and everybody can enjoy that. If you've seen Jaws and you've heard bum 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 bum, you know what it does to you, right? It's just as much character in the story as the shark.
No question.
It's cool stuff.
It is very cool stuff, and we've got a lot of cool stuff coming up. You're hearing this in March, and so our Lady Catamounts basketball team is heading to the SoCon tournament along with the Catamount men's basketball team, and so we wish them all the best of luck for a great showing in Asheville. Right?
I'm very excited to go watch some Catamount basketball. Last year's SoCon tournament was a thriller. I'm hopeful that this year's SoCon tournament will be even more successful and thrilling for our basketball teams. And it's, I got to tell you, the privilege and joy of watching these teams play. In particular, Ben and I just saw the men's team last night. What a great group of guys, and what a fantastic time they have on the court. When they're playing well, it's joyful to watch them. There are a handful of other things, though. Ben, have you picked out like your green pants and your green suit jacket? Because you, my friend, are going to Ireland.
We are. We're taking a group of alumni and donors and friends to Ireland to celebrate the Pride of the Mountains marching band marching in the St. Patrick's Day parade in Dublin, Ireland. And so
so fun.
It is a lot of fun, and we've got a great group. And you know, getting the students over there and being able to take the pride on the road across the ocean, it's a real privilege. And so we're looking forward to being able to tell some really neat stories when we get back from Ireland about our students and how much fun we've had in Ireland.
First time the band has performed internationally. I don't know if Ireland knows what's about to happen. They may not be prepared for us.
There's going to be a lot of purple and a lot of drums that arrive in Ireland. And so it's going to be a great, great showing. And if you can figure out a way, I don't know yet. Hopefully we'll know by the time this airs of how you at home can watch the Pride in Dublin. And so we'll hopefully be able to check it out.
I think the best thing you can do is get yourself a plane ticket. Fly to Dublin, get a pint of Guinness, and sit on the side of the road and cheer.
Absolutely. You can do that.
That's what you're going to do.
You can have my ticket.
Okay.
Anybody at home. Really, you can have
email Ben Pendry at wcu.edu. Hey, listen, I hope you have a great trip, and thanks for going over there and being part of that, and take lots of photos for us and send them back. I have one other big, big, big thing coming up that I'm going to talk about.
You're right. My birthday is April the 21st, and thank you for giving our folks at home the ability to get a head start. I like running. You know, I play
Ben,
a little golf every now and then.
Ben, do you turn 40 this year?
It's a big one. It's 40.
Oh, yeah. Everything falls apart. No, it's April 3rd I wanted to talk to our audience about. One day for Western, and if I could just have a minute of your time, One Day for Western is our campus day of giving. And all across the university, we have some really exciting and important priorities for ways that you can help us make the experience here at WCU even better. I say this all the time. I'm never embarrassed to ask others for their support for WCU students. The students here accomplish incredible things, and our programs are doing great, great work. And you can help make that even more successful. We don't talk a lot about fundraising here on Western Wednesdays, but the opportunity to give back to Western is one that I take as an enormous privilege, because I know how it benefits our students and our faculty and our programs. And I want to just invite you all to be sure to open the email, click the link, answer the phone call or the text if you get one, share the message on Facebook or Instagram, One Day for Western on April 3rd. Ben, I know your team has been working hard with our deans. We've got some great priorities and some challenge gifts lined up already.
You'll find a challenge gift that speaks to you in your college or department or unit or a thing that you were involved in when you were at Western. It means something to those students and our faculty and staff when they see that alumni from these programs, supporters in the community, stakeholders who care and watch Western, when they see your name on the roll of supporters, it means something to them. And so James is right. It's an absolute privilege to be able to talk and to ask on their behalf, because what they're doing is it's meaningful and it's making a difference in their communities and in your community. So do click on the link, answer the phone, reach out, let us know what we can do to help you make your gift on One Day for Western.
And if you're interested in what those priorities are, you can go to oneday.wcu.edu and take a look, take a gander, and otherwise hope to see you all showing up on April 3rd as we try and make a difference here in Cullowhee, North Carolina for these students. So thanks for your help. And Ben, thank you.
Thank you, James.
My gosh, fun as always, my friend.
Always fun. Thank you, Sam Wallace, the man who makes the magic happen behind the camera.
Good stuff. Thanks for listening to Western Wednesdays. And as always,
go Cats.
Go Cats.